How wonderful to be present today in this very, very special place for a very, very special man, Chief Justice Stuart Rabner. And truly, since each of us has been invited by Chief Justice Rabner, we all must be very, very, very special people. My name is Janine LaRue. I am one of the three deputy chiefs of staff for Governor John Corzani. And I'm honored to be asked by Stu to officiate this ceremony today. Of the many hundreds of people in this place today, I probably have known Stu Rabner the shortest amount of time, just 19 months. But we have bonded in a way that I'm convinced that our friendship will last for many years to come. And I look forward to the future in that respect. Often when I officiate or emcee events or ceremonies, I wake up in the middle of the night and I wonder, what did I forget? So Justice Porras, this morning at 5 o'clock, I said, oh my God, the stool. Where's the stool?
Leave. So at this moment, we're going to introduce to you the lady of his life, still his bride, Dr. Deborah Rabner. Would you please stand up? And the woman we're going to buy tickets to when she goes on stage, we'll hear her today. Madame Erica Rabney, she's going to sing for us. Little Stew in the making, Carly Rabner, please stand up. And this next Rabner, Governor, be glad he's not old enough to vote because he'd probably beat you in the next election. Jack Rabner. We're now going to take time to acknowledge our guests, and as I said, all of you are so very important, but there are some people Chief Rabner wanted us to point out. First of all, we have his brother, Howard, and Hillary Rabner, and we have his their children, Lauren and Jonathan. Where are they sitting? The other woman of his life, Sarah Weiner, his mother-in-law. And everybody can get sick in the Rabner's family. They have loads of doctors. So as brothers and sisters-in-law, Doctors Ilana and Burton Zurich and Doctors Bruce and Gila Kriegel. And of course, son Ari. And we have former Chief Justices retired, Justice Poritz and Cezalli. All of the current and former members of the Supreme Court are with us today, and that's exciting. And I said to Stu, when he told me all the names of the other members of the court, I said, there won't be any sentencing today because we have most of the appellate court, the superior court, and the federal court in this room today, and we thank you for coming. Our legislative leadership, Senate President Dick Cody, Senate Minority Leader Lance, Speaker Joe Roberts, Assembly Minority Leader DeCroach. All right, we're almost done. I know you're tired of clapping, but we have just a few more that we want to acknowledge. There is a group of folks here, we call ourselves the front office. And Stu is always going to be a part of that family, always. Led by our wonderful Chief of Staff and Madame Moran, I want to point out all the members of the front office here today. Would you please give them a round of applause? We also have members of the Governor's Cabinet, and I'm going to special out one person, the newest member, Attorney General Ann Milgram. Finally, we can do nothing without religion. So we're going to recognize, is Rabbi Cutler here yet? I know he's on his way because he's bringing his mother, and Stu is very, very proud that his mom wanted to come. We also have Rabbi Silverstein, Bishop John Smith, great, and Reverend Jackson. At this time, we're going to be honored with the invocation from Chief Justice Rabner's former roommate. And because he's a rabbi now, he won't tell us any secrets, but I'd like to sit down and chit-chat with him sometime there, Stu. Rabbi Wesley Garden Swartz, Esquire. This prayer will be followed by Stu's daughter, our star, Erica Rabner, who will sing America the Beautiful.
Thank you, Janine. Yep. I have known your new Chief Justice for 25 years, since we were roommates together. Now, while all of us here know the many wonderful personal qualities that Stuart possesses that are going to make him an outstanding Chief Justice, I'd like to share with you where those personal qualities came from. Stuart is who he is because his parents are who they are. His mother, Stella Rabner, alive, thank God, to take in this unbelievable moment. And his late father, George Rabner, Olav Hashalom, may he rest in peace, who passed away a few years ago. Your new Chief Justice is a first-generation American. His parents came to these shores as refugees from the Holocaust and as immigrants. 40 members of their family perished in the flames of the Shoah. And somehow, Stella and George managed to survive 6 years of labor in a Soviet labor camp. And they came to New Jersey to rebuild their lives. They had no money. They had no contacts. They had no formal education. But what they did have the strength of their character. And they did have their integrity. And they did have their unrelenting work ethic. And they had an imperishable faith that despite all they had been through and despite all that they lost, life was beautiful and worth living. And worth beginning again. And they brought into this world two incredible sons, Howie and Stuart, whom they raised in an exceedingly modest home, 19 Donald Avenue in Passaic, New Jersey. Now, the Talmud tells us that if people love one another, they can live together on the edge of a knife. And if they don't, well, the biggest mansion is not big enough. And the four Rabners live together in this small home full of love and full of all the right values. And Stella and George eked out a modest existence at a store called Pals of Pequannock. And they began their shift there at 6 o'clock every morning, a store that sold newspapers and magazines, soda and candy bars. And your new Chief Justice, together with Howie, spent the Sundays of their youth working at that store, bundling newspapers, and selling candy bars. The Jewish tradition teaches, Ma'ase Avot Siman Levanim, that children live what they learn. They pick up who their parents are and what their parents do. And the values that Stella and George lived out now define Chief Justice Stuart Rabner. Stuart has this incredible work ethic. When I was his law school roommate, we lived together for 2 years down the hall from one another. And I'd go to bed and turn off my lights at 11, and I could see through the hallway the light of his room where he was at his desk studying away. The light never went out. And he had this work ethic that came from two parents who created life again out of nothing. Stuart is truly humble. His humility is the real McCoy. And that comes from spending your youth at Pals of Pequannock. Stuart has this totally rare combination of soft and hard. He's soft, he's compassionate and gentle, nurturing. But oh my God, his will is made of iron, stronger than iron. All of you know that. and the people that he prosecuted for more than 20 years came to discover that. And Stuart is passionately committed to fairness and integrity and to justice. When he was a senior at Princeton, his senior thesis was entitled "A Commitment Compromised: The Treatment of Nazi War Criminals by the American Government." And I just want to share with you his tribute. This is his dedication page. "For Ziesel, my namesake, Moshe Laser, Nissel, Israel, Hinda, and Etya, Rickel, Ajik, Gedala, and Bronya, Ben Sion, Berta, and Ajik, Josie, Scheindel, and Heschel, Reza, Sala, Joseph, and Jenia, and Joseph, Fanny, and Eric, Solomon, Trude, Gerda, Walter, and Ali, Chaim, Basia, and Samuel, Janka, Bernard, Janek, and Ali, Herman, Berta, Hella, and Halina, and dear young Edgia, 40 of 6 million. And so we pray, dear God, please be with and please bless now the Honorable Stuart Rabner, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of New Jersey. May this moment bring together now power and wisdom, power and integrity, power and compassion, so that this court will be a beacon of your light, and so that the citizens of the state of New Jersey will live in a society of justice and of mercy. And for this, let us all say, Amen.
Beautiful, for heroes proved in liberating strife, who love their country more than self, and mercy more than life. America, America, may God thy gold refine, till all success be nobleness and every gain divine. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesties above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crowned thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. America, America, shining
right? First of all, Rabbi, I don't have to call you. Well, you told us all we needed to know here today about Stu. And Erica, unbelievable. And folks, if you want to hear something, the whole family sings. And it is absolutely amazing. Thank you so much. The other man of the hour, we have two of them here today, is the man who's truly responsible for all of us being in this room. There are a lot of traditional introductions of this gentleman floating around. I chose not to use any of them because I'm not traditional and he's kind of used to that by now. So I'd like to go back to a marvelous article that I read in the New York Times right after his accident. This visionary of a man said to that reporter, and I quote, "If I knew for certain I was going to run for re-election, or if I knew I was going to be re-elected with certainty, or if I knew I was even going to be alive, if anything I've learned in the last 6 weeks is you can't always anticipate events." He went on to say that I believe I have a chance to shape that court and have an impact on the direction of judicial philosophy for a very long period of time. And I think we ought to seize the moment. And you know, folks, we live by clips. I'd gotten up very early and I'd read that in the paper. And I got so excited when I saw that. And I emailed him. He doesn't read emails anymore, but. So I was so moved, and this is what I shot off to him. I said, "I am so pleased and so proud of you, Governor. And I said, I want you to just read this little poem. It's my favorite poem. I would hope that you even learn to memorize it," which I'm sure he didn't. It's so short, but we'll work on that. The poem says, "I've only just a minute, only 60 seconds in it, forced upon me, can't refuse it, didn't seek it, didn't choose it, but it's up to me to use it. I must suffer if I lose it, give an account if I abuse it, just the tiny little minute, but eternity is in it." And so the man who used that minute to make a decision that will impact our lives forever, please help me welcome the very honorable Governor John S. Corzine.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you. Janine, I wondered why you went to 6'2" here. I think I'll use this stool. It might help me get a few of my speeches across to the legislature when we're here. It's great to be with all of you on a moment of celebration, a moment of respectful honor to a really terrific individual. I'm only regret that I can't speak as well as Erica can sing. You were beautiful, Erica. It is a really true honor for me to be able to speak at this investiture, recognizing the 8th Chief Justice of New Jersey Supreme Court, since 1947, of course, Stuart Rabner. and it is a pleasure to look you in the eye and call you chief. I think I've been doing that for a long time anyway, but let me also recognize two people who I'll speak to Janine later about. There are two governors, people who served the state with great honor and respect. Governor Byrne, Governor Florio, we thank you very much. I also want to recognize Judge Debevoise, who I think Stuart probably would say he knew nothing about the law until he had a chance to clerk and be a protege of one of the great legal masters of our great state. We welcome you, Judge Debevoise. I'm pleased for a lot of reasons. It's always great to celebrate a moment in someone's life where there's an important passage. But it's also important to celebrate the high expectations that we all embrace when we know that we are making a very strong statement about our future. It's always important to understand the individual and exceptional merit of an individual, but when Stuart takes this oath of office in a few moments, it's really about more than constitutional duty and the formal passage. It's about the possibilities that America presents, that this great state of New Jersey presents to individuals, about the promise that we all embrace. Rabbi, your comments about Stuart's parents, Stella and George, who lived the American dream, live the American dream today, and by the way, Sheila did as well, who experienced some of the greatest oppression of the world, but with hard work and commitment and an optimism and a belief in the future, led to a full life. They built a business, they raised a family, they gave their children the hope and the dreams that I think all of us carry for our children as we go forward. And Stuart, I think you, like most of us, know that we stand on the shoulders of giants. And today, the son of two immigrants takes the oath to be the most senior jurist in this great state. In this room of fully esteemed guests, I want to say once again, Stella, you, your family, your generation embody all that it is that we dream about in this country and in this state. And you have set a sterling example for your son and for all of us as we go forward. You know, Stuart, it's a little hard to come up with new things. I've been introducing you nonstop, it seems like, for the last 19 months. But if you will extend me a little gubernatorial courtesy as opposed to executive privilege, I'd like to say that you did not need this appointment to deserve the deep admiration of your peers or the citizens of this great state. As I said, as a protege of Judge Debevoise, a respected prosecutor, professional prosecutor for 20 years, the first assistant to the U.S. Attorney, Chief of the New Jersey Terrorism Unit and post-9/11 period, Chief Counsel to the Governor, which is undoubtedly the hardest job you've ever had, and the New Jersey's Attorney General for such a short time. Some of us began to wonder whether you could ever hold a job, actually. But by deed, you have earned your place in New Jersey's annals. You've established yourself, and I believe this fully, as one of our nation's brightest legal minds and talents, progressive in outlook, sound in judgment, and disciplined in the practice of law. You've defied labels like liberal or conservative, and you've earned a reputation for impartiality and for the commitment to justice. Approaching every issue, as I've heard you say over and over again, with the simple question, what is the right thing to do? Through it all, you and Deborah have set the kind of example your parents set for you, for Erica, Carly, and Jack, passing on that generational promise of greatness that America holds. Build on that foundation, and you have done well. Howard, I know that you have experienced that as well. But no one knows better than you, Stuart, that we breathe life into our values through the work of our lives. Your professional life has been one to the commitment of the rule of law. And the rule of law is one of the great commitments we have as a society to each other, so that we can live one with each other. And you will carry that forward in the days ahead. And the challenges that lie ahead for all of us are extraordinary. And we do have high expectations for you and the court. Our Supreme Court faces all of the great issues of our times, complicated ones of education, making sure that our health care is provided in an indisparate way, civil rights, and I could go on. The court is where justice and the challenge of the ages of justice are decided. And you will have a singular role in shaping that response, both in the high court and how our judicial system works across the state. Cooperation and deliberation with your colleagues, which is an extraordinary court, here in New Jersey, it will be your judgment, their wisdom, your sense of compassion, and your steady hand that will guide us, I hope for many years into the future, will help determine the kind of society, kind of people we define ourselves as. Let me close by observing that made a few decisions in my life, had several careers, probably have a couple more. I've never had the opportunity to work with an individual with greater integrity, intelligence, or heart than Stuart Rabner. Let me close by saying I know you will make an indelible impact, not just as a justice, but for the cause of justice. And like your friends, family, and colleagues, and all of us who are here to join you today, I'm terribly proud of you, Chief.
Governor, that was wonderful. That was wonderful. You fired me for not mentioning the governors, but you made a wonderful speech, and that was great. I'm so sorry. I know. So right now, you've already heard his name. We are now going to present to you a gentleman who Stu is just so very close to and owes so very much to, and that is the judge that he did his law clerk for. I think he did it for 1 year, coming out of law school. So Judge Debevoise, there you are.
I was going to start by addressing the various categories of dignitaries who are here. But Ms. LaRue and Governor Corzine did such a good job, I think I will skip that formality. And I will just start in by saying that I'm sure you can imagine the joy with which this event gives me and how honored I am to be able to say a few words. You will have to forgive me if I refer to our Chief Justice as Stuart, referring to him as Chief Justice in the years which I will address, I would hardly seem fitting. To prepare for this occasion, I turned to the dossiers I maintain for all former law clerks, and I pulled out the one labeled Stuart Rabner. And the first entries reflect the interviews my then law clerks and I had with this Princeton graduate and about to graduate outstanding Harvard Law School student. Our written comments foreshadowed, not that he would become a Chief Justice, but that at some time he would play a significant role in public life. A few of my then law clerks' post-interview comments were, he chose academic subjects with social significance, bright, personable, sincere, and he has a welcome sense of humility, a quality which I hope he will continue to preserve through the years ahead. I put down as my comment, after meeting with him for about 45 minutes or an hour, he has a great range and depth of interest, an articulate, confident, but not overbearing individual. I also noted he ultimately ceased to work in New Jersey, perhaps in the U.S. Attorney's Office. Fortunately for me, Stuart came with me. His co-clerk was another outstanding person, Mary Sue Hennepin, and we had a wonderful year together. As every judge knows, a special bond develops between a judge and his clerk. The judge for whom I clerked, Philip Foreman, once and always referred to his clerks as sons-in-law and daughters-in-law. Stuart's dossier is a continuing record. It covers events both known and less well known. One document describes Stuart's reactions as he reached the 3-year mark in the U.S. Attorney's Office, serving under United States Attorney Samuel A. Alito, Jr. Stuart reported, I also tried my most amusing case this year against two inmates at the Somerset County Jail who ran a stamp washing enterprise out of their jail cell. They are now proceeding pro se and raised 44 points in their motion for a new trial. Fortunately, Stuart prevailed on all 44 points. The dossier does not recount Stuart's subsequent ascent to the court, to the first assistant U.S. attorney, chief of the criminal division, and chief of the terrorism unit, and the extraordinary work he performed during those periods. Those were matters which were, except as reported in the press or in open court, too confidential even for my dossier. But other qualities were revealed. As has been mentioned by the rabbi, our Chief Justice, or our new Chief Justice, is a great singer. In his younger years, he was the male lead in the Y Repertory Company of Clifton, New Jersey, starring in Oklahoma, Bye Bye Birdie, and Oliver. He was a professional cantor for a number of years, and I see these talents carry down into the next generation. But he asked me once if I could find a choral group that he might join. I mentioned to him Judge Bissell's barbershop quartet. But with all respect to Judge Bissell, this was not quite what Stuart was looking for. Stuart was only a modest softball player. At early clerkship reunions, we played the game in my mother-in-law's dairy farm, cow pasture, complete with cows. The venue did not permit Stuart to perform to his utmost ability. The venue did not suit his performance particularly, and in one letter he wrote, "We'll miss dodging those cow piles in the outfield this year." There is also reflected in the dossier the happiest of events. Stuart's marriage to Deborah, also a professional, and as the years passed, the arrival of Erica, Carly, and Jack. The whole family has to contribute when a person enters major public office. When Stuart was offered the demanding position of governor's counsel, he conferred with his family. I understand that his son Jack asked if that would mean he would meet the governor. When Stuart said yes, Jack said, "Go for it." "Jack, I'd like you to meet Governor Corzine." Now let me take you back to an earlier time, which was covered so eloquently by the rabbi who spoke and had the invocation. The events of which I am sure molded Stuart's early life and subsequent career. and which will strengthen his commitment to this task as Chief Justice. One of the most moving presentations I have ever heard was Stuart's remarks at the service on the occasion of his father's death. Having survived the Holocaust, Stuart's mother and father, as has been described, left Poland for the United States, and as also described, starting with the newspaper candy and stationery store, they created lives for themselves. Children were born, and as they grew, they all pitched in the store and elsewhere. From these parents, they learned what is important in life, what is truth, what integrity is, and why truth and integrity must never be surrendered. Years later, Stuart's senior status at Princeton was entitled, as previously described, a commitment compromise, the treatment of Nazi war criminals in the United States government. We often discussed this subject, and it was dedicated, as described in detail, to the host of cousins and other relatives who perished in the maw of the Holocaust. One senses that Stuart and his family are moved by the conviction that they must give to the life of the community what the lost relatives were prevented from giving. It is not surprising, therefore, that the first place that Governor Corzine met Stuart Rabner was at a soup kitchen where each was serving as a volunteer. New Jersey is fortunate to have had a succession of great chief justices, starting with Chief Justice Arthur T. Vanderbilt and proceeding through Chief Justices Joseph Weintraub, Richard Hughes, Robert Wilentz, and most recently, Chief Justices Deborah Poritz and James Zazali. The courts they led each faced moments of crisis, and each acted with strength and wisdom. In the appointment of Stuart Rabner, Governor Corzine, and the legislature, have continued this tradition of appointing great chief justices. In the years ahead, our state and our nation will face untold crises. The New Jersey Supreme Court will be called upon to act in these crises. We are fortunate that the person leading the court will be Chief Justice Stuart Rabner.
So it's appropriate. That was the appropriate speaker, and it's the appropriate time. We are now going to interact with the man whose name we have heard so much about today. You haven't seen him yet, and you're not going to hear him yet, only see him. We're going to ask if the Honorable James Zazali would please come up. He will swear in our Chief Justice, Stu Rabner. The Bible will be held by Dr. Deborah Rabner and accompanied by the children. Stu's mother and brother will assist him with the robe. So we would like to get on with the ceremony.
And in this state,
under the authority of the people,
under the authority of the people, And that I will perform the duties of Chief Justice.
And that I will perform the duties of Chief Justice.
Of the Supreme Court of New Jersey.
Of the Supreme Court of New Jersey.
Faithfully.
Faithfully.
Impartially.
Impartially.
And justly.
And justly.
To the best of my ability.
To the best of my ability.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Governor Corzine, Chief Justices Azzali and Poritz, Governors Byrne and Florio, Governor and Senate President Cody, Minority Leader Lance, Speaker Roberts, Minority Leader DeCroach, current and past justices of the Supreme Court, judges, legislative leaders, family, and friends. Thank you for joining my family and me for this very special occasion. To say that I'm a bit overwhelmed by the events of the last 2 months is to understate things a bit, and today's ceremony merely adds to that feeling. Our MC, Jeanine LaRue, is an exceptional and charming public servant, and I'm grateful that you agreed to oversee today's program with your usual warmth and grace. Jeanine and I, as Jeanine mentioned, developed a very close friendship from when we started out in the governor's office, and while Jeanine told you about our birthday, she did not share a secret that my mother just let me in on, Jeanine, and that is that we're actually twins separated at birth. Which explains our deep friendship, but Jeanine is actually more complicated than it may seem at first blush. Because when my mother told me that, she also asked why it is that you haven't written over all these years, or called, and I'll leave it to the two of you to work that out together over the reception. My dear friend, Rabbi Wesley Garden Swartz, you've honored us by traveling so far to be with us here today. He is not only supremely articulate, but he's someone who speaks from the heart, and that's why so many are drawn to you and to your words, Wesley. Judge Debevoise, when I think of the qualities that make a great judge, I think of you, your humanity, your wisdom, your overriding sense of decency and fairness. And I know how privileged I was to have had you as a mentor more than 20 years ago, and today, tomorrow, and the next day. Governor Corzine, I cannot find the words to say, to express the deep feeling of gratitude that I feel right now. For the rest of my life, I will look back with great pride at the privilege of having served as your chief counsel. Lawyers don't get to pick their clients. The system sounds that way, but it doesn't really function that way in reality. Our obligation is to serve with vigor and with professionalism whatever client we may end up with. But to have been able to serve you in that capacity, a person of your character, your vision and passion, your high standards and sense of integrity, was the opportunity of a lifetime. And I thank you for selecting me among so many qualified people you could have selected to serve as Chief Justice of our Supreme Court. When I took the oath of office some 3 weeks ago, I joined a long line of justices and chief justices who, including the current members of the court, have served it with such great distinction and have earned it a reputation that is second to none throughout our nation. That was not always the case. Prior to 1947, New Jersey's court system was known in a very different way. With its 17 different courts, cases would be shuttled from court to court, with litigants just fighting to find a real forum where they might seek vindication of their rights. And when they did, delays of 2, 3, 4, and sometimes more than 10 years were not uncommon before they could get a ruling on the merits. Our system regrettably resembled a story that Charles Dickens would have delighted in telling. In a 1943 work entitled The English People, the author D.W. Brogan wrote, "If you want to see the old common law in all its picturesque formality, with its fictions and fads, its delays and uncertainties, the place to look for them is not London, but in New Jersey. Any law reformer of a century ago would feel more at home in Trenton than in London." That is quite an accomplishment, but hardly a ringing endorsement. Reforms were hard to come by, led by the efforts of Arthur Vanderbilt, who would go on to be the first Chief Justice of the modern era. One strong voice in opposition was Jersey City's legendary and powerful mayor, Frank Haig. And to appreciate what the reformers were up against, let me share with you, briefly, Mayor Haig's philosophy on individual liberties. "We hear about constitutional rights, free speech, and the free press," he said. "Every time I hear these words, I say to myself, that man is a Red. That man is a communist. You never hear a real American talk in that manner." That may make us smile today, but can you imagine Arthur Vanderbilt thinking about sitting across the table from Mayor Haig to negotiate a more progressive, more efficient court system for our state? That's why ultimately the fight was taken directly to the people. And the reformers prevailed, as we know, with the citizens adopting the Constitution of 1947. This new Constitution, along with additional reforms over the years, resulted in a consolidated court system, an integrated, unified system with, as its preeminent focus, doing justice in the individual cases that come before it. The portraits of these great chief justices and justices from that era and since then stare down from the walls of the Supreme Court's space, its conference room, and elsewhere. Those leaders are responsible for the advances of the modern court, but notwithstanding their great accomplishments, I think it's fair to say that the court does not belong to them. I'm delighted that these proceedings are taking place in the Assembly chambers, and I thank the Speaker for opening that up for us today. And the reception later, I'm equally pleased, will take place at Drumthwacken, and thank the Governor for opening up his gracious home to us. I'm pleased not just because of the rich history and the magnificent beauty that those chambers represent, but because gathering in both places for a judicial function is a symbol of respect by the judiciary for two co-equal branches of government. And beyond that, it's a reminder that this majestic chamber, like the space where the Supreme Court meets, belong more to people like my father and mother and countless others like them than to any government leaders. My father never set foot in this room, hardly ever set foot in a courtroom. Once to take the oath of office, several times after when summoned to serve on a jury, he never sued anyone, no one ever sued him. And in those ways, I think he was typical of most citizens of our state, of our nation. People who go about their daily lives trying to earn a living and raise a family with a faith that while our system may not be perfect, it functions fairly and properly and will be there for them if they ever need it. Our responsibility for those of us in government is to live up to that reasonable expectation of the people and to always keep in mind that the majestic halls in which we're privileged to serve in public service belong not to those of us who may grow comfortable in them because we work here, but to the vast majority, like my parents, who rarely, if ever, set foot here. How do we carry out that pledge of public service to them? By maintaining a sense of humility about the power that is entrusted to us and an appreciation for how that power can affect people's lives in ways that we can't even foresee. By striving for excellence and the highest standards of integrity in all that we do, and by accepting and embracing the responsibility of protecting individual rights as guaranteed by our Constitution. This task, though, does not belong to the three branches of government alone, because public service is an obligation that we all share. In this room are many leaders of the legal community, people who have served the greater good in a variety of forms, whether serving on a community or civic board or a hospital board or coaching Little League or founding and sustaining think tanks or legal services organizations, perhaps by serving on bar committees or getting involved in political campaigns. How do we transmit this sense of service to the next generation? Because after all, students aren't flocking to law school, dreaming about the number of billable hours that they can amass as compared to their fellow associates, or hoping that one day they can tell a grandchild about the number of weekends they devoted to poring over discovery documents. But in a world with growing business pressures and an increasing emphasis on the bottom line, it's not hard to see our young generation of lawyers headed in that path. Our job is to make sure that they understand that they can serve individual clients professionally and at the same time use their law degrees to make a meaningful difference for the community as a whole in a number of areas. To the extent we may have strayed somewhat from that, we can correct our course, because our future as a legal community is one of shared obligation, where each of us can and must play a role in serving the greater good, motivating others by individual efforts and acts of leadership. Let us continue. Let us resume that journey with small steps that will have a broad and lasting impact. I'm not a big fan of speeches where the person up front spends a long period of time going through dozens and dozens of individuals who are deserving of mention, but there are a few that I must pause to speak to. Let me start with Donna Annapete, who's not simply an extraordinary legal assistant who runs the court, as most people know, but she doubles as a wedding planner and takes care of every nitty-gritty detail for days such as today. My comments about Jeanine LaRue earlier apply equally to Tom Shea and Maggie Moran and Patty McGuire and all the others on the governor's senior staff with whom I was privileged to work. I didn't have a great deal of political experience coming into the job as chief counsel, but I had something better. I had these talented people to learn from who always, always had my back, and I couldn't ask for anything more. I'm also fortunate to have had the benefit of the advice and counsel of my good friend Chris Christie over the years, who couldn't be here today because he's on vacation with his family out of state. One Friday in December of 2005, Chris called me into his office and said that he'd had a conversation with Senator Corzine, where he'd recommended me for the administration. And the following Monday, I was having lunch with the governor, and so began a journey that has been unpredictable and remarkable. And I'm grateful for Chris's good words and his advice. There are so many others in the legal community who have helped me along the way. Forgive me for only mentioning one more, Mike Critchley. I don't know where he is, but I hope he's here somewhere. When Mike heard that I had an interest in becoming a judge a number of years ago, he volunteered to help me. And I was amazed at the number of people that he reached out to, and amazed because we had a professional relationship, not a close personal friendship that would have motivated him. So I asked him at one point, "Why are you doing this?" And he said simply, "Because the bar benefits from strong judges." I know Mike will do likewise in the years ahead for others. And what I would ask of others who are fortunate to climb the legal ladder as Mike had, is that you do the same when you have a chance to help good people who may not have political rabbis to open the door for them. Doing so not only enhances the bench, but it gives hope to extremely talented lawyers who would serve with distinction if given a chance. I have so many reasons to thank my family, my mom and dad, for their determination, their inspiration, and their love. My children, Erica, Carly, and Jack, who are stars, each of them, and each a blessing. And among the many things you do, know exactly how to make sure that your mom and I never lose perspective on what counts in life. My wife, Debbie, best part of my day is when I get home and get to steal away a few minutes to talk about whatever details we can share with each other from what had happened during the course of that day. I know how lucky I am to have you as a partner in life, to have you stand with me in all things, without which I wouldn't be here. And finally, I want to acknowledge and thank those giants depicted in the portraits that I referred to earlier that are in the Supreme Court space. Chief Justices Vanderbilt and Weintraub, Hughes and Wilentz, and no doubt someday that gallery will increase with Poritz and Zazzali. They created and burnished the image of excellence that the New Jersey Supreme Court stands for. And they left to all of us the task of maintaining and enhancing its luster. I pledge to try to do so each day that I'm privileged to serve on the court. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
It's been a wonderful day, hasn't it? We have come to the close of this program. We have one final speaker who will give the closing comments and the instruction for the rest of the day. At this time, we're going to bring up another one of my friends, retired Chief Justice Deborah Poritz.
Today, in this historic and beautiful room, you have witnessed the orderly transfer of office that is the hallmark of our system of government. It is fitting that we gather in this place where ordinarily the Assembly meets and where both houses of the legislature come together to hear the governor address the citizens of New Jersey. Today, the governor, the justice of the Supreme Court, and many others, too numerous to mention, honor the head of the third branch chosen by our governor with the advice and the consent of the Senate. It is an historic occasion. By these ceremonies, we celebrate the continuity of office, the legacy of the past, and the promise of the future. We recognize the ways in which the executive, the legislative, and the judicial branches intersect, and we mark their independence, their freedom to act, each in its own sphere, for the public good. We honor an institution, the judiciary of the state of New Jersey, reshaped under the Constitution of 1947 into a paradigm for state courts across these United States, truly independent and strong. We honor the man chosen to lead the courts for the achievements that brought him to this place and for the strength of character he has demonstrated along the way. I served 10 years in the office that Chief Justice Rabner now holds. Those years were challenging and rewarding beyond measure. The judiciary I came to had earned a national reputation for excellence. Its highest court was known for scholarly and well-written opinions that paved the way for other courts in consumer protection, in the law against discrimination, in land use and zoning, in reproductive and other fundamental rights. I learned then that the Chief Justice wears two hats, that the Chief Justice is the administrative leader of the court system and the judicial leader of the state's highest court, the first among seven equals. The demands of those two responsibilities are daunting. Chief Justice Wilentz told me from his hospital bed a short time before he lost his battle to cancer that he had never learned how to balance the administrator and the judge. He told me to spend less time administering the courts and more time thinking and writing. It was advice not easy to follow. The system requires constant attention. The system is insistent. The administration of justice can be all-consuming. Balance is difficult to find. Yet, in the end, the best advice I have to pass on to Chief Justice Rabner is to search for that balance. And he knows this. The governor said it. To always do the right thing. Chief Justice Rabner, you must find your own center, your own course. We know you to be a man of unquestioned integrity and substantial intellect, and we know you believe in the rule of law and the search for justice. I can think of no greater qualifications for the office you now hold. I am proud that the mantle has passed to you, and confident that you will wear it with distinction. All of us in this chamber congratulate you and your family, and all of us wish you well on your journey.